church, to not do anything to make people feel out of place so you can hear the gospel. When there is a time, we look at people and say this. We want you to match up and say to God, hey, I need that. I need that. So what I'm going to do is this. I'm going to ask you to bow your head. And if you would gladly receive, if God asked you and said, I'm willing to roll over you today. I'm willing to roll in and take care of your needs. I'm willing to give you peace in the midst of your storm. If you're in a spot where you gladly would accept the Lord, maybe I want you just to show him just a hand, or maybe you sit in your chair and bow, whatever you can do, I want you to acknowledge to him and say, Father, I accept that. And man, I want us to bring that course again. I want us to sing that just quietly, reverently. Father, we just ask you today to meet with us. God, we need you, Father. It's not like we're going to meet you halfway and make you better because of the time. But we just desperately need you. This love that's curious, that's strong, that breaks down walls, that heals peace. The name of Jesus that says to the storm, be quiet, and the storm without reservation is quiet. We just want to be in that master's presence. See what you got today. God, I just pray for people who not even know who you are yet, that you would speak to them today. Seaside is like a primo, like a very high-end place. I was looking at a real estate board. It was a 4-bedroom, 3-bath house, just, you know, small sum of $1.65 million. And in my mind, I'm like, $12,000 a month mortgage is what that would be, you know. We all went in together, we could sleep in the closets and the floors and, you know. But so this guy rented this whole hotel, and so we went in on Tuesday night, and they had like some little hors d'oeuvres, and a guy got up and said, "I just want to bless you in Jesus' name," and read some scripture and prayed over us. I was like, well, there's no timeshare yet. You know, I put on my no face later time. You imagine what's coming. You know, I'm like, he's going to. Well, that was Tuesday night. And then Wednesday, they said, by the way, if you want, you can turn your room key in and get your free complimentary bicycles. Get this people quaint. Bicycles. And they're not like, they're like the little girly kind. You can't be manly riding these bicycles, you know, around the seaside. Birds flying over, the soft wind, and you're riding a bike. So Wednesday morning, we have a breakfast. I'm like, this must be when the pitch happens. When they tell me about the timeshare, and if I put $100 down, and I get 10 people, put $100, and I'll get $12 in 20 years, whatever. And we come to breakfast, and Chad leads 3 songs, and then the guy gets up, and he reads the scripture, and says, "We're just really thankful for you. We love you. We want to bless you in the name of Jesus. Amen." I'm like, well, they're waiting to the end. They're going to get us punch drunk on ice cream and seafood, and we'll be staggering around and we'll feel guilty at that point. So I'm like, it's going to come Thursday night. So Thursday night we go in, and again, it's this room, it's 60 pastors and wives. There's no denominational tie. So you've got like AG guys and Southern Baptist guys in their pockets, and you got some Methodist folks, and you've got people all different kinds of backgrounds. And so during one of the worship songs, some people started speaking in tongues. I'm like, who's an interpreter? And they were cool with it. And I'm like, but we're getting ready for the pitch. Like, they're going to set it up, and they're going to have somebody pop up in the room. And say, I did this last year, and I put in $500, got $5,000. And yet, they just loved on us. They've been kind to us. The rooms are killer nice. I check the rates, because that's what I do. It's like $2.99 a night. I'm like, good Lord, they got to get something out of us to pay for this. There's 60 of us, and my mom's like, well, there's 60 people, and that's, you know, 3 nights, probably a good deal, $7.50. I'm running all the numbers. Well, last night, they get up and sing 3 songs, and a guy gets up and shares a story about how they want to reach more pastors. He says, now's the hook. I'm like, all right, and I'm like, hand on a lock. You know, and he says, all we ask is that you bring another pastor with you next year. And I'm a business guy. I understand business. I understand numbers. Like, if we drive by a house, and I see it for sale sign, I didn't mean to. I'm looking at, I'm like, you got a house. I know I'm on the payment. I'm running the numbers and what you can make from it. That's how it works. And he said, we just want to love pastors. And the story is, the guy that runs the place has made him give him the money. His dad was a minister. And he said, I early on realized ministers are broke and they don't have time. So I started giving them, I want to give them time away of their families. I want to give them something elaborate and significant and generous just to bless them. And they said this. They ran the numbers. They asked how many we all had in our churches. And they said, by us doing this week, we think we're blessing 20,000 people. And that night, I laid in bed, I'm like, God, what is this all about? And the Lord just reminded me, as he does, because he does that, that that's what the gospel is. It's lopsided. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't mean that you meet God halfway and you put half down deposit and he tells you some kind of deal that you got to agree to so you can make money as you're up on. It's this wonderful, out of proportion, God deciding to love you in spite of you, in spite of your doubts, in spite of my, I want to keep my hand on my wallet and I lock my billfold up in the little safe in the room, in spite of all that. And the Lord kind of reminded me gently that if we would do that here and continue that, because that happens here in a lot of ways, but do it bigger, do it better, be more extravagant, be more lopsided, do more things that make no sense. It makes no sense what they do. In my mind, they dropped $100,000 for that weekend. Ran all the numbers. They asked full-time staff and things. I'm like, well, what benefit is that? How does that even help them? They didn't ask. I don't even know where to mail money if I wanted to mail money in. Well, they figured that out. Doing one in September in Gatlinburg, they're making it longer in 4 days, and we want to bring 120 pastors. Then one of the guys on their staff is going to go to seminary just to meet pastors. Think about that. Think about the extravagant nature of that. And it's a picture of what the Lord wants to do in your life and in my life. It's the gospel. It's God saying, I love you in spite of you. I love you in spite of your reservations and your hang-ups. Today, we're in this cool series, and we're talking about upgrades. I want to, a couple things. If you haven't checked in yet, so my sister asked, how do you check in? If you have Facebook on your phone, it's a little teardrop thing with a dot in the left. Okay? If you check in, it should say the Calvinist community. It might try to check in other places around, but get on Facebook, sign in, or the blank spot at top says, what's on your mind? Click a little teardrop and check in there. That helps us with the ministry. We have last month's, they hadn't sent us the update, but last month was 6 check-ins provided a daycare for a kid in need in Haiti. Is what we're trying to take care of. Every month's a different thing. So that's one of the ways we reach out. The second way, I want you to know, we always update these numbers because of your giving. We have given over $13,600 to the Orphan's Hands, our international ministry we're tied with. And that's an awesome thing. Philip and I talk about it, and it's growing every month, which is a pretty amazing thing. And your dad said something one day to me. He said, I prophesied. He said, I believe as you take care of people, that literally there's no way, we're not getting any tangible return, right? Is that fair to say? We're not getting a tangible return, but that's the way that the Lord works. You bless those, you're not doing it for any reason. You're just doing it because God told us to. We're not getting higher attendance. They're not coming in and taking care of our kids. We're just blessing people around the world. And so my prayer is that that would be a quarterly number, the number that's on there, or that would be a monthly number. And we say, look, we give 10% right now. What if we up to 20 or 25 or 30 and watch what God did? So be encouraged. The giving that you give, it may not seem like much, but the lady in the Bible that gave the widow's mite that small bit, she made the book. She made the book. And the rich people who gave out of their overwhelming abundance, that it wasn't a sacrifice, didn't make the book. But she had little and she gave all. And she's the one that Jesus chose to teach on. And so for you, be encouraged. I'm giving, Blair talked beautifully about it last week. It's about your heart. It's not about your checkbook. I have a pastor friend that says, he said, if we really baptize people as they looked, we baptize and keep their right butt cheek out of the water. Because that's the last part of their life gets redeemed, is that wallet cheek. You know, you keep that wallet out of the water. Can't get that wet. Yeah, that's the part that God gets last. And really, when you learn this, it's a lesson that you have to learn personally. When you learn this, you will be encouraged to remember every time you tithe, every time you give, that God is faithful. He shows up in ways we can't see otherwise. And so we send that to you lovingly. It's a discipleship thing for us. We want you to get this. We're going to Cuba. We're still working with details of that. But if that's on your mind, please let us know. We've got to pull some big triggers quickly on that. Something you can have, if you're interested in going, make sure your passport's in order. Make sure you can take those days off. Email myself or Blair. We'll give you some more information about that. The trip's looking like it's going to be about $1,100. The church is going to try to step in on some of those things to cover some of that expense. We're going to help you with some writing some letters of support. But we're going to Cuba. Cuba's a closed country. Somebody said, isn't it communist? I was like, yeah, it is. Somebody says, is it safe? I'm like, I mean, it's like being God's will is safe, but as far as God is safe, that's a whole question. But if God wants you to go, you need to go, I'll tell you that. It's way safer than East Chase, if that's where God wants you to be. I mean, it is. If it's not where you want to be, anyway. So this morning, we're talking about upgrade, and we've been looking at these individual aspects. We talked about greed last week. We're looking at individual aspects. This week, I want to give you kind of a picture of a person in Scripture whose whole life was upgraded. And so, if you look, there's a guy in the Old Testament who is the father of our faith. The Bible says that Abraham believed God. We're talking about Abraham today. And there's two stories. We're going to look at two chapters of his life, Genesis 12. Then we're going to fast forward. This is a lot of really great stuff. And look at Genesis 22. I want you to look, we'll just kind of talk this together. These are ideas for you as you're looking and saying this. Maybe I believe that God has a better life for me than I have. Maybe God is drawing me into something. See, we're sitting at this conference and we're on the porch, and a lot of preachers, that means you have small thinking. Anybody ever met anybody with small thinking? And they have small thinking. And I don't want to throw anybody in the bus. But we're on this porch, and they're talking about what it must have taken the money-wise to make this weekend happen. And we're all just kind of blown away by this because we're all like tightwads, and most people in this are making money. And we're all sitting on the porch, and they're going, you know, if you get rich, it just leads to, you know, bad things and all this stuff about money. The Bible says that money leads to bad things. It's the love of money, infatuation, idolatry of money. And they were saying, I just want the rich people in my church. I don't want to be the rich guy. And I said, you know what? I want to be the guy that can give $100,000 worth of conference. I want to be that guy. I want to be the guy that can write a check and say, you know what? I would have loved them to say, hey, as you leave, here's a $200 gift card. You go home, find a hurting pastor, take them to dinner, love them. That'd been a cool add-on. It would have cost another $12,000 to do that, but that'd been a cool thing. And I think for lots of people that your thinking is small, that you think the life you have, that God just has maybe a small percentage better version of what you got designed. Like you're like living a 1,300 square foot life, and maybe if we save up and get a side job and get some side hustle, we can go up to a 1,700 square foot life. And that'd be, we'd be robbed then. And we'd get the fence with the pickets, and we would be the junk. That's what we think. And God's looking at us, and he must shake his head and go, I've got a life for you, an upgraded, better life than you could ever imagine. If you ever meet somebody that drives an old car, have old cars, they don't drive them for the upgrades. You know that? If you have an old car, when I was in high school, my Mustang would just break down at random times. Most times, like dates, important events. That car, if you turn right, it would honk. There's somewhere. And it never failed to be like a woman I had no intention of dating. That was a larger lady in front of my car. And I'd be turning and go, and they wave, and I'm like, it's broken. No interest. We're good. Go. Go back to Walmart. You're good. And you don't drive old things. You drive them for the nostalgia, maybe the conversation, but you never drive them because they're upgraded. You never drive. If you get a new car, don't you love the new car scent, the smell? Larry and Lady lives in new cars. I joke with Christy all the time. Christy gets new cars because he lost contact as a family, and 1 year Christy didn't have a GPS in her car, and it just set her up. You were upset. And I jokingly called you Diva, and that's true. But you know, she didn't have the one thing she really wanted. Because she expected that hello. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that. I mean, I love the Terry's, anyway, we love them. But for us in our lives, a lot of us are going, you know what, I just am okay with this low one day. And what if God was knocking on the door of you and saying, I've got greatness designed for you? And what if you just say no your whole life, and your life ends, and you look at God, and you get into heaven, and he says, before you receive an inheritance, I want you to know something. I don't want to be bittersweet, but you missed out on a lot. There's a guy in the Old Testament who did not miss. He did not miss. He was not perfect. His name was Abram, later changed to Abraham. We're going to look. This is the moment. Abram was in a land, in an area that's Iraq right now. You can actually go to his house. A friend of mine has been to Abraham's house. 4,000 years ago, this all happened. Even though they know where it was. They were moon worshippers. They were godless people. They had not heard of Yahweh, Jehovah, the God of the Old Testament. And yet, in the middle of all this, God speaks out of the darkness and calls this guy Abram just because he calls him. It's a pretty awesome story. Here's the call. Genesis 12, verse 1 says, now the Lord said to Abram, you're going to hear two names. Abram is his old name. Abraham is going to be his new name. We'll talk about that in a minute. The Lord said to Abram, go from your country. Look at this. It's going big. Go from your country, from your kindred, which is like your tribe, and your father's house. It's getting bigger, bigger, bigger. From your father's house, to the land that I will show you. And then go to verse 2. And I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you, I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Say 75. So we're going to look at this guy Abram today. The first thing I want you to understand is something you need to write this down if you forget things you don't write down. The first thing is that God invites us to blessing. That God invites us to blessing. God looks at you wherever you are and he calls you to a better place. Now we just sang some lyrics that said that you are for us. Is that good news? Let me say this. If God was against you, you'd be smited and dead before you thought about it. People, God will live the way y'all want to live because God's allowed. When people hear the gospel and they go, man, God's working on my heart, but I want you to say no to him right now because he's allowed it. The sovereign God of the universe does what he wants. This song, Sovereign Over Us, it's got that funky music. Can you hit him your legs with it?
Oh, God.
Yeah, it's, you should just sing them all going, oh, counting is hard. But you know what? That's probably the most accurate song we sing. Over all of us, God sits enthroned. We don't see Him. We don't understand Him. His ways are mysterious. But know this. God, in His wisdom, looks at you and says this. I call you to blessing. I call you to a life. Now, blessing is not just richness. Some people think that. Blessing is I call you to a life with me. Following my steps, following my patterns, following my ways, following my words. That's what God calls us to. And I want you to look at this blessing. Number one, about the blessing, that God's blessing is conditional for Him. Now, what in Genesis 12 says, and God called Abraham and said, if you'll follow me, He gives 7 blessings. And then verse 2, it said, and Abraham said no. Is that exciting? Jenny, is that worth it? There's no King Arthur Bible studies written on that, right? Abraham said no. Abraham said yes. Here's what happened with that. Out of his line came King David and all these cool Bible stories and ultimately Jesus. Our salvation is based on this dude in Genesis 12 saying yes. God's blessing to you is conditional. You have the right. A sovereign God can let the leash slack up. He can say, I will ask you to follow me. And sometimes people say no, and He says, okay. Sometimes they say no, and He breaks them. Get their attention. If God has broken you, it means He cares enough not to overlook you. That's a good thing. It's an encouraging thing. I've met people that God said, follow me, and they said no, and He just moved on. That's a horrible place to be. God's blessing is conditional. In other words, God asks you, and you have a responsibility to respond. I will tell you this. If God's calling you, consider it a privileged invitation of God's calling. So it's condition number two. It's covenantal. Covenantal means it's literally between two parties. There's a cost to both sides. For us, when Christ says, come follow me, He says, give me your life. You could go turn the TV today and find people on TV that say, just say a little prayer and you'll be saved. The Bible, Jesus says, not everybody that says, Lord, Lord, enters the kingdom of heaven, but those that do the will of the Father. Christ looks at you and says, I want every bit of you. Is that fun? You know, nobody sells things in the world that way. You don't go to Sears and say, I need a bed. It's going to cost you every penny you got. Well, I just want to pay $1,000. Nope. I need your future, I need your kids' blessings. I need everything you got for this bed. It's just a king size. It's not that great. Everything for the bed. No, we make things cheap. The gospel says, I want everything. Every ounce of you. This is a horrible marketing plan God has. But it's the beauty of the gospel because Christ says this, if you give me all of you, I'll give you all of me, and I'm way better than you. It's covenantal. It involves two parts. The Bible, a covenant, was always made with blood of an animal. The Old Testament explains covenants. They take a cow or an ox, and they literally split it. We would split it like halfway down the side. They split it from like nose to end. It's hard or boring. And they lay it out. And the person that's in the covenant would walk through the blood of the entrails. It's horrible. I'd be like, I'm supposed to be worshiping. I'm throwing up on the side. That's how I'd be. And you walk through it, and the idea is, if I break this covenant, maybe it's hard for me to break this covenant as it is to put this animal back together. That's the idea. It's bought with blood. So that's the Old Testament. That's covenant, 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 covenant. And the New Testament says that Jesus comes and offers a new covenant. That He's the once and for all lamb. That Christ was not only the priest who made the sacrifice, but He Himself was the sacrifice. It's this really cool, complete picture of God saying, I got it all. I've got the action. I've got the thing needed. And you can't even do it, but know this. I'm inviting you into the covenant. That's what God says to us. So God's blessing is conditional. It's also covenantal, and it's also exponential. The number 7 means perfection. You see it all over the place. You see it when it talks about Satan. Satan's number is what? 666. In Revelation. It's almost complete, but it's not. It's almost perfect, but it's not. Then number 7. On the 7th day, God did what at creation? He rested. 7 all over the place. And so God, in Genesis 12, looks at Abraham and says this, if you'll follow me, I'll give you 7 blessings. Here are the blessings. He says, I'll make a great nation from you. Abraham is basically a nomad at this point. He's living in a tent. And you're making it into a nation. Okay. Number 2, I will bless you. Now, when you go, I'll bless you, it's not a big deal. When God Himself says, I'm going to bless you, that God has everything at His disposal, it's a pretty big deal. Number 3, I will give you a great name. In a minute, He changes His name. Takes it from Abram to Abraham. Number 4, you will be a blessing. These first 4 are personal things. God looks to Abram and says this, if you'll obey me, I'm going to do these really cool things. Number 5, I will bless those who bless you. This sounds like mafia to me, doesn't it? Like, I'll break your legs. And next, I'll curse those who curse you. And God says this to Abraham. He says this: if you'll follow me, if you'll just do this one act of obedience and the following acts, here are the seven things. And then it says, you will bless the entire human race, which is a prophecy about Jesus. That Abram, because he simply obeyed, here's the thing, you have no idea today, you're obeying God, what's going to do for your family. Some of you parents, you have no idea, you saying yes to the Lord, whatever that means. It may mean to be a small group leader here. It may mean to actually be a part of Catalyst. It may mean to invite somebody for work. You have no idea the exponential actions, the ripples of what you do, how it's going to affect the world around you. You may not even know that until you get to heaven. You may not. I believe that God gave Abram a little glimpse. I think Abram, he had to be reminded at some point, like Genesis 15, God's inviting him again. He says, look up at the sky. And Abram looks up at the sky. And God says, your children are going to be like the stars in the sky. Let's say on a clear night, you hold your arm out and take a dime, and a dime covers up, if you can see in the forever, covers up 10 million stars. And God says to Abram, if you'll just follow me, I will bless you beyond anything you could even imagine. So God invites us to blessing. In Genesis, look at that fourth one. He says, you'll be a blessing. Or number three, I'll give you a great name. Here's what's interesting. In Genesis 11, remember the Tower of Babel? Remember that story? Genesis 11 says, the people were together and said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face here. If God had told them to keep going, they would have camped out and stopped. Here's what's interesting about that. God promises if we'll honor him and follow him, he'll do the things we can't do on our own. They wanted to make a name for themselves, and God said, no, if you'll follow me, I'll give you a name, but not otherwise. Think about your life. Think about, are you trying to build your kingdom, or are you trying to build the kingdom that God has designed for you? This is the call. In Genesis 12, we're going to fast forward 10 chapters. Look at Genesis 22. Bunch of stuff happens. Abram was 20. He was 75 years old when God gives this promise. He and his wife Sarah were childless. They were old even by that standard then. They had no kids, and God's saying all these things about kids. In the meantime, his son had been born, Isaac. And here's what God says. After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, he said, here am I. God has given him a new name, the name that there were father nations. Verse 2. And God said, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering. Does this sound encouraging? Do you hear burnt offering and think, Burnt offering involved taking the animal, quartering it, cutting out its entrails, draining it of its blood, putting it on a fire and burning it. So God in Genesis 12 says, we'll make a great nation. It has to start somewhere. The blessing is the child Isaac. And then in Genesis 22, God says to him, take that offering, that gift, that blessing, and you make a burnt offering for it. Now, where Abraham was from, they had practiced child sacrifice. He had seen that before. They were pagans. They did horrible things. He knew what it involved. Verse 2, so offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I will tell you. Verse 3, so Abraham rose early in the morning, sat on his donkey, and took two of the young men with him and his son Isaac. And he cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place in which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Verse 5, then Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey, and I and the boy will go over there and worship and then come again to you. There's some pretty cool references in there. Verse 6, and Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son, and he took in his hand the fire and the knife, and they both went of them together. And Isaac said to his father, Abraham, my father, and Abraham said, here I am, son. Isaac said, behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Verse 8, and Abraham said, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my sons. They both went together. I want to teach you some things, show you some things about this that may be looking at you and your upgraded life. I talked earlier that God invites you to blessing. Every person in here, God's inviting blessing. Every person you know, the person who's most difficult for you at work. I saw a meme the other day that kind of kicked me in the face and had a picture of Trump and Hillary. It says, Jesus Christ died for both these people. I was like, I just don't want that to be true. I want Jesus Christ to smack both these people. be praying, seeking God for Tuesday. So God offers blessing to anybody that will take it. Here's the second thing you think about. Abraham was 75 when this promise was, the call was given. It says later on that he was 99 and his son was born. How many of you like waiting 25 years for your blessing? We have, you ever been to McDonald's to see that little timer? If your food is like 47 seconds long, you can complain about it. Think about that. Think about how far we've come. Any of y'all, any folks who really like to cook a lot? Christian Curry's good cook. Matt Ward's good cook. Matt gets a good rip. If I give you 47 seconds, Matt, what kind of delight you will put for me? Not much of anything. Not for anything. And so we have this idea that we want things instantly. This is 25 years in the delay. Here's the point to remember. God sometimes delays, but he never forgets. Some of you may be sitting right now and saying, man, I felt like God told me what he wanted to do in my life. But I don't like the wait. And know this, you have not been forgotten. It says in verse 1, after these things, Genesis 12 to 22 is the things. After these things, God tested Abraham. So number one, God has not forgotten you. You may feel forgotten. Your emotions do not control the reality of what God is doing. Your perspectives don't change his sovereignty. If they do, you're God. You need to crawl off your cross. You're not God. God is God. God does what God wants to do. God sits on the throne above the heavens. If you don't feel that way, go look in Job chapter about 40, 41, 42. At some point, Job's had a pity party. Things are so bad, God. And God says, I'm going to question you. And Hebrews says, and you will answer me like a man. Well, I imagine that Job probably voided his vows when God says, you'll answer me. I'm going to give you in for three chapters. God says, where were you when I blank? When I formed the heavens, where were you, Job? When I told the snow where to come from, where were you? When I put the constellations in the air, where were you? When I put the wind in the air and told it where to blow, when I told the sun to go to sleep at night and come up in the morning, where were you? And for three chapters, God says them over and over again, I'm God and you're not God. So know this today, be encouraged. God may be delaying for you, but you have not been forgotten. So you need to go home today and mock the mirror somewhere. I have not been forgotten. God has not forgotten. You need to find scriptures that remind you of God's faithfulness, even though God might be distant sometimes, that God has not forgotten. Number three, God's committed to the process of shaping you into his image. And he's been impressed with more than we are. When we talk about being saved and Christ followers, we would like to think that the minute we become Christians and all of our issues fade away, right? Tonight at small group, and I still hope we share our request. If I come up to all of you and said, write in all your prayer requests this week, and this is just the reality of who we are, most of our prayer requests would be things that would take away pain. Do you agree with that? And yet, when do we pray more? When things are good or when things are bad? When do we grow more? On the valley or on top of the mountain? On the valley. And so the thing that we ask God to take away is usually the very best thing for us. That's hard. You got to have a pretty good theology to understand and think that, man, God might be working even in this pain. God might be working. God might be doing greater because it's harder than if it was easy. Maybe God's trying to shape my character. Maybe the Lord's trying to teach me to trust him more than to trust the stuff he can give me. I had a book I read that said, if your prayer list only consists of the things God can give you and not God, then God's your Publix or your Santa Claus. So we pray because we want more of God. We don't pray because we want more of God's stuff. So God's committed to the process. So after these things, God tested Abraham. Nobody enjoys testing. You look that up, it needs testing. We didn't sugarcoat it. God tries us. There are times God, and I don't think God does it so he can see what we're made of. I think he doesn't see what you're made of. Think about the toughest thing you've been through. Anybody think of that? Yeah, our family, Matt. Think of the toughest things you've been through. Look back at it. Look how far God's brought you through. Was God faithful? Yes. Kim was God faithful. Matt was God faithful. You have a milestone to look back and say, well, this isn't so bad because we went through hell last year. And God knows those things because he's committed to growing your character more than your comfort. So think about that. After you've seen God test Abraham and said to him, Abraham, and Abraham said, here am I. Fourth thing we want to know is the obedience calls for sacrifice and action. Now, we would rather have a Christian life that says it's just easy, that everything's nice and dandy. But know this, like it's sacrifice. Verse 2, God said, take your son, your only son. What does that sound like when they said? For God has loved the world and gave his son, his only son. John 3:16. Take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. Now, in Genesis 12, we saw God tell Abraham to do something. Abraham. And we don't know the time frame. It doesn't tell us. It doesn't say that the next morning Abraham got up. We just know that he obeyed. Some people have said it was years. He had to like get his resources. Some people said it was the next day. But look what this says. So Abraham rose early in the morning. The Hebrew says he rose early the next morning. Whether there was a delay before, Abraham has learned. He's learned how to act. He's learned how to obey. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, took his young men with him, and his son Isaac, and he cut the wood for the offering, and rose, and went to the place God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Know this today, if you're a follower of Christ, it's going to involve some obedience and some action. We had some people that were a part of our church and want to do it. They said, it's just too hard. I want to go to some place where it's easier. And I'm like, Christ does not call us to the easy. God never called us to be consumers. We're not supposed to go and like, treat church like Best Buy. Go try like I do at Best Buy. It's horrible. If you work at Best Buy, I apologize to you. Because I go to Best Buy and I manipulate you and you show me all the features and I get your opinion and I buy it from Amazon and my market. I just do. I apologize for you. If your aunt or somebody works at Best Buy, give them $5 in my name. I'm sorry. Church is not designed for that. It involves sacrifice. You follow Christ means there will be a day if you obey him, he'll say, do something that won't be fun. And he's just going to do that. It may mean difficulty. It may mean work. It may mean offering. I don't know what it means, but it means that there will be a day, the scripture shows it, that there will be a day if you follow Jesus, it will require sacrifice and also require action. Let's keep going. Take your son, your only son, and you'll be able to make a burnt offering. The next thing I want you to learn is that everybody's not ready for the mountain. Look at this. Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. I, the boy, will go over there and worship and come again to you. So stay here. The King James says the asses. Leave the asses behind. I heard a preacher one time say, you need to leave all the asses behind. And then he went further. Here's what we're talking about. There are two groups Abraham did not take, the donkeys and the servants. So here are some of the donkeys that are left behind. They're mean donkeys. You ever met that mean donkey before? You ever met them? People that don't need to go with you? They're mean, just mean. They just like being mean. They stir up strife. We're talking with my nieces last night about some teenage girls that do that right now. And we're talking about there are going to be grown women who do that, right? Terry, they're going to get better. When you hit a donkey, you don't get cured of that. You get that in money. This gets worse. You get louder at the microphone. So they're mean donkeys, they're doubting donkeys. You ever want to go somewhere and somebody doubted you? You had a vision to do something great, and somebody said, oh, you can't do that. We had those when we started this place. It's like, well, you don't have any money. Okay. And then you can take that date, they're like, well, you don't have any time to a nomination. I'm like, praise God. I mean, that's good news to us. I mean, I think. So they're doubting donkeys, there's biting donkeys. You ever worked with a donkey before? We have them, our family has them. They bite you, they come around trying to bite you. Like, there are people that you literally aren't going to take up the mountain with you. Because if you do, you're going to have to watch your back the whole time. There's gossiping donkeys. People that talk bad about you, good or bad. They're half-hearted donkeys. They don't know where they're going. If you're Blair visited the Grand Canyon last month, I got to tell you something. I would have an interview with the donkeys going to walk me down that canyon. I'm going to test the speed. Had him on the back, I'm going to lean on him a little bit. And if he did a, I'm like, hey, I don't need a wuss on me. I need a legit drinking milk, doing some donkey push-ups. I need that on me. You got to be careful who you ride with. And think about this. Think about your life and the people. And I believe that mountaintop represents God and the best things of God. The Bible's full of it. The mountain always represents, they got the Ten Commandments on the mountain. Jesus went up to the mountain and prayed. The Holy Spirit came down and showed Jesus in the little mountain. The mountain always represents the best things of God. Know this though, you can't always take everybody with you to that mountain.
That's right.
There's some people that don't need to go with you. You need to love them, be kind to them, but you don't need to think they're going to always go with you. And then there's grumbling dolphins. And the servants, the other group, they may not have had the master's heart. They may be in it for themselves. They may not have been fully committed. Whatever the reason was, Abraham said this: y'all got to stay here. It's just me and my boy going now. Now, parents, think about if you've done a good job raising your kids, they probably kind of act like you, and that's good and bad. Probably have your mannerisms. They get your family's ideals. They know what you seem as quality. They understand what matters to you. And that's who Abram took with him on the mountain. Point number six is you got to make sure you're taking somebody with you. And our environment means this. I believe that God's calling us to upgraded lives. I believe that. I looked at Ronnie. Ronnie, do you think you got a little bit of upgrade the last few years? And I thought of you as one almost like your face with a bubble coming out of your mouth. Ronnie told me, my goal, if I can believe one person Jesus take with me, I've achieved something. Have you already had that happen, Ronnie? You have. Ronnie has an upgraded life. Now, Ronnie, I pray that God would blow your mind that that will be one, it'll be 1,000 or 1,500 or 2,000. Or that we got, hey, Ronnie, we got to start a church somewhere. You going to be a pastor of it? Ronnie's like, shut your mouth, Matt. I put a hat on. But what if God's calling you something? What if, look at your life and say, turn around, who am I taking with me? Now, parents, we have a responsibility to disciple our kids, to raise our kids. But other than that, who are you need to pour into? There are people that would be sitting in these boys if you invited them. And I don't mean that you break down, let me get out my Bible and give you with 10 spiritual truths that will change your life. If you simply said this, hey, come join me on a Sunday. They got a guy named LeBron in the scene. They got a guy named Kenny or Christy or John. They got this guy, Drummer. He gorillas. I call him Drummer. They call his name Drummer. He gorillas and drums. He's awesome. Or this guy, Reed. He's got luscious hair. He plays guitar. Whatever. Richard can wear out the bass. Whatever. If you invite them, it's amazing how many invites don't get responded to if they're not asked. It's all of them. There are people that if you have faith and I have faith that you can be discipling and follow Jesus in the next month. If we have the courage to just say, okay. Kids can do it. Middle schoolers, high schoolers, singles, married. You gotta look and say, who am I taking with you? In verse 6, as Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering, laid it on Isaac his son, and he took in his hand the fire and the knife, and they both went together. What we're trying to do here is for you and I to look at people and say this, hey, I want you to go, God's upgraded my life, God's changed my life, I want you to be a part of it. It's really hard to say no to that, by the way. It's really hard. I was talking with a friend of mine that planted a church in Dothan, and he said that they have instilled in their church the idea that people are supposed to bring people, and they have doubled every few years because people have gotten it. That their job is to bring people with them. They don't do advertising, they're not in a great location, but they said people are supposed to bring people. And I want us to get this. I want us to think about this. God, if this journey is not meant to be alone, ask yourself, who do you intend for me to take with me? It's got to be more than our kids. It's got to be more than just the people we meet here. There are people that God has put in our paths. That the upgrade for you is not just about you, but it's you saying, I'm going to pour my life into somebody. You don't know how much that means until you're the lonely one. You ever been there before? Go someplace to a restaurant and eat by yourself. People think you have leprosy. I did that. There's a place on Lakeshore in Birmingham. I go to seminary and I have a break between classes. There's a Chinese buffet. It's good food. I go sit and eat. They say, how many? I go, one. A little lady goes, oh. And I'd go sit, and I'd sit in the seat, and he'd be at the little table that everybody walked by. And I'm sitting there, and people walk by, I'm like, oh, I don't like that anymore. He's so, and I'm like, I have friends. I want to say, I have 3,000 Facebook friends, and they're real. I know them. But think about those people that maybe you're the link that says, hey, I want you to be a part of what God's doing. Simple way I said that we all want to be double next week. Richard, we got no tears for that?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. We have plans, but we got to do it. We got to look at somebody and say, hey, I want you to come. And don't go find anybody at another church. They're good there. Find somebody that's hurting. Make you a little awkward. That may not have how to talk. Just do it behind them. Last point, this is the point for today. The thing that makes us all matter is that God has provided everything necessary for you and Jesus. Do y'all get that? Does somebody agree with that? God provided everything. Look at this. Isaac said to his father Abraham, my father, and he said, here I am, my son. He said, behold, the fire and the wood I see, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? This is the whole Bible right here. This is like the whole Bible. God will provide for himself the lamb for the burnt offering. So they both went together. The story is that Abram, the rabbis teach that he literally had the knife raised. Hebrews says, if you look back, I think verse 6, Abraham says, the boy and I will go worship, we will come back together. Now, this is a man that had gutsy faith, because he knew this, God was calling him to murder his child. That's the first thing. He was going to obey. He didn't come this far to fail. Hebrews says that Abraham either believed God would provide or God would resurrect his son on the spot. Because it says, the boy and I will go worship together, and we will return to him. Abraham is his father of faith for all of us. Guess what? Abraham is looking, without even knowing this, looking through the ages, and he's seeing Jesus, what Jesus is going to do for us. He's saying this, even if he takes my whole life, he's going to give me a better life. I don't have to look elsewhere. Abraham is this picture of what Christ is going to do for us. John 10:10, the verse of this whole series says, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus says, I've come that you might have life and have it abundantly. I just want to remind you that Jesus is calling us to blessing. He's calling you to a life that is better than what you know. Anybody agree with that? I don't mean riches. I don't mean a bigger house. I mean this. God was calling you to a life. This last week at this retreat, it wasn't fancy. But I tell you, when my buddy hit the keyboard, we started singing Blessed Assurance, and 120 preachers and their wives busted up singing, this is my story, this is my story. Wonderful. Wonderful. And God calls us to a better life. He calls you to a more effective life. He calls you, maybe, I don't have any effect on anybody around me. God calls you better than that. You may say, I can't even speak in front of people. God might be calling you to teach something. Well, I didn't hear people doing a pretty awesome job this semester. Margaret. For good things. Catherine heard the same thing. Other people who've never done that before. God might be calling you to do something bigger and brighter and better than you've ever imagined. But you've got to, just like Abraham, you've got to step into it and say yes. We're about to sing in Christ alone. This is this verse. God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering. If you don't know Christ, I'd love you to talk to you about him. We can talk afterwards if you'd like. If you do, and maybe you're distant from him, I encourage you to sing. These altars are open for you to come pray, do business. Let's pray and sing. Father, thank you for today. Thank you for Scripture. Thank you for this father of faith that we have in Abraham. God, thank you that he obeyed you. Father, thank you that he did the hard things that made no sense to us. He put his most precious blessing on the line to simply obey you. Lord, I pray for all of us to have a more intense, more real walk with you, Jesus, that we would be devoted like Abraham was. Follow you no matter what it means. Even if it means you've got to move supernaturally. We'll pray all this to Jesus. And you guys stay in the same